In this picture of me from about 10 years ago, clearly I have a lateral pelvic tilt. Or do I? Is that lateral pelvic tilt because I have a lateral pelvic tilt, or is it because my mandible, my jaw, is tilted? And I can pretty much tell you that the lateral pelvic tilt was not a lateral pelvic tilt. It was a visual representation of dysfunction, of imbalance throughout the rest of the system. Pelvises don't tilt on their own, independently of the rest of the body and independently of the respiratory system. And that's what I'm going to talk about. I had a lateral cranial tilt that over time, many, many years, led to that outcome. And that is the point of this video. From a postural restoration perspective, a lateral pelvic tilt with the right side higher is actually very easy to explain, and it's the most common scenario. Because of the bigger right diaphragm, which you see a picture of, and because of how our brain processes sensory input, particularly our peripheral vision on the right side, it preferentially processes peripheral vision. Try saying that three times quickly. It preferentially processes right peripheral vision compared to the left. Our bodies like to orient themselves over to the right side of our body. So when that happens, our weight, our pelvis turns to the right. So the left side comes forward, the right side comes back a little bit. That's the left AIC pattern. As our body weight shifts over to the right side, when that occurs, the right leg turns in into what we call right AFIR. That's a pelvis postural restoration term, talking about how the acetabulum, so the pelvis itself, and the femur turn in on each other into internal rotation. And when that occurs, that pushes the right side higher. That's normal mechanics. That's completely normal if you're over on your right side. And if you're in a left AIC pattern, that's what you are. You're over on your left side. That's what the pattern is describing. So having a right side slightly higher is a completely normal position for someone who's stuck over on their right leg. The problem is that there are upper body influences. So if you have a pelvis that's higher on the right, what you're also going to have is a rib cage that's lower on the right. So these two sides are coming together. So just working on the left hip, like a left AIC type of program, is not going to work by itself, because now you're also going to have all of these muscles that are likely overactive at the same time. So you're going to have a right abdominal wall, the right lat, the right intercostals, the right pec minor. All of these are going to be overactive because you're down on that right side. So you've got to have a program that also inhibits all this right side activity. That's all great, and that could work pretty well and pretty easily. But what if you have what we call pathology? That's the next picture. When you have pathology, it means you have range of motion in areas that you really shouldn't have it due to the position that your body is in. So if I were to test somebody and I ascertain that they are stuck or they're living in a left AIC pattern, they shouldn't have the ability to rotate their torso to the right very effectively. If they do, then we know they've probably stretched things out in places that shouldn't stretch out. And one of those places is this iliolumbar ligament that attaches from the lumbar spine to the ligament, I'm sorry, to the ilium of the right side. That is to control rotation, so you can't over-control, so you can't over-rotate and hurt yourself. When that iliolumbar ligament has been stretched out, you'll have too much rotational ability through your lumbar spine, and that can cause a lot of problems and pain because that's instability. So that's a pathology. So someone with a lateral pelvic tilt and is very unstable, if they have an iliolumbar ligament pathology, they're going to need a lot more care or help than just a couple left hamstring or adductor techniques for the left side. There's instability in that system. If you like this video, could you please like it, share it, or better yet, subscribe to the channel and make sure that you get the notifications clicked so that you can get notified when a new video is released. Thank you. The second place you'll normally find pathology, I would say the vast majority of people that I work with live and online, but who I can test, have ligamental laxity in the front of their left hip. So the anterior left hip ligaments are usually stretched and weak. And that's the vast majority of, and that's where most people's pain comes from. It's not the pattern itself, it's the pathology that builds up, the instability that builds up in the front of the left hip and potentially in this lower right back area, that instability, when it's unstable, your brain will not let your weight go to your left side. The problem is, if you don't ever use your left side, it's going to get weaker and weaker and weaker, and the left leg is constantly going to be trying to externally rotate. As it does that, it stretches out the front of the hip capsule, and that's the compensation. The left leg turns out to stay straight, so you can walk straight. Otherwise, you'd be walking in a circle. As that occurs over time, and you're lifting weights and running and playing soccer and football and basketball and doing all these other things that require large amounts of force, you start to stretch out that anterior hip capsule. Now, when that becomes unstable and weak, you have to tighten up other areas of your body to stabilize you. And that's, again, another reason. Now you're going to be overusing your, particularly on the left side, your hip flexors and your lower back muscles. When that goes on for too long, and that's to stabilize the left side, when that goes on for too long, you could end up a PEC. You could end up with a left side higher because now you've contracted those muscles that become so tight and overused. I'm not going to say tight. They become so overused, they could pull you into a left-sided tilt. So the tilt can be on either side. I'm not going to get into the left side. But just realize that most people that I work with have instability, at least in the front of their left hip. So again, just doing a couple techniques, probably PRI techniques for the left side, probably is not going to set, is probably not going to resolve everyone's lateral pelvic tilt. They're going to need help. And if you give them, if you're doing techniques and they cause pain, they're not the right techniques for you because there's probably stuff going on upstream, higher up, that you don't know about. So that's why people need a complete program, not just a couple or a few exercises. So you got to be really careful about this. Just trying to do two or three exercises that you might not even be ready for is not a good way to go about it. You need to find a postural restoration trained therapist from the website who can help you. But let me go a little bit further up the body and show you what other muscles could be involved. Your back is probably going to be tight. And so those paraspinals, however you want to say it, those can be very overactive, which will be keeping your body in a state of extension, which is going to make you a neck and back breather. And so you have the breathing dynamics also that have to be addressed at the same time that you're addressing the tilt of the pelvis. And finally, when you come to my situation that I showed in the beginning, this I'll show the picture again. Once you have a jaw that's mispositioned, all of the side of the head, this is what the right TMCC pattern is, all of the jaw musculature on the right side and the right neck, the right SCM, the scalenes, and all the anterior neck, that will all be involved in pulling you into extension and then keeping you over on this right side even further. So the origin, my lateral pelvic tilt that I was living in for such a long time had nothing to do with the pelvis. I ended up in that position from higher up. The whole system was imbalanced from the time I was 11 years old when I got put into that position because of orthodontia. Well, the jaw was in the wrong position, and then they fit my teeth around the wrong position. They weren't checking for airways. They weren't checking, obviously, to see whether my jaw was positioned properly. They weren't checking my body for ranges of motion. They were just fixing teeth, and that's problematic for someone whose jaw is not positioned properly. My whole PRI has tons of classes, has seminars dedicated to this area. And you could say that the point of postural restoration is all about keeping this area balanced. If this is balanced, the lower body is going to be in pretty good shape, and your PRI programs are going to work really, really well. When this is unbalanced, like mine was, because of a jaw position that's either mispositioned, too far back, an airway that's closed, a tongue that doesn't have enough space in the mouth, any of those oral cavity issues will affect this whole complex. And once the neck gets overactive, it always comes back to the neck, once the neck gets overactive, it pulls you into extension, and this is what's causing the tilt. The tilt is just a victim. It's just a symptom. It's just a visible sign of disequilibrium, unbalance in the system itself. I'm not saying, this is the good thing, I'm not saying that most people have this going on. I'm saying people with more than just a little lateral pelvic tilt, when it's getting a little bit more extreme or more visible, they're definitely going to have something going on higher up. It still may not get to the level of up here, but you're definitely gonna have to work on breathing and expansion of the rib cage. The point is that it's not always so simple, like, oh, do a couple exercises and you're going to be fine. So what's the solution? You got to find someone who can identify all these things, test for all of these things. And from my experience, you're not going to find that except from people who have been studying postural restoration for quite some time. It might involve a dentist. You never know. But again, luckily, most people probably don't have to worry about the cranium and the teeth. Some will. But almost everyone's going to have to address the upper body from here down as part of what's causing their lateral pelvic tilt because of the respiration and the breathing issue, the compensatory breathing that's going on when your body isn't stuck. And all this upper body musculature has to be inhibited so that pelvis can finally get to the left and you can start to stabilize. And don't forget about the pathology that goes on in the front of the hip and in your lower back.